Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, thrill seekers, budding blues aficionados from the West Side, and patrons of this wonderful music hall. When I first walked in here, I just went, oh, this is perfect. And that's why we're shooting a video, recording the sound, just so you know, so it could wind up on YouTube someday. So what I'm going to do is tell you the story of the blues from my perspective of reading American history my entire life, and also many, many books on this very subject. And I encourage people to ask questions like, what do you want to know, or what do you want to hear more about? Because I could sit up here for 5 hours and talk and talk and talk and play and play and play, and nobody's going to sit through that. So the show's about an hour and a half long. I'm more than happy to stay after if you've got questions. But please feel free, as this thing stumbles along, to ask me what you'd like to know. So the way I started off is there was a fellow named Alan Lomax, and we all owe a great debt to that guy and his dad, John. John and Alan Lomax, actually, they worked for the Library of Congress, and they are the guys that went into the penitentiary in Louisiana, I think, and got Lead Belly out of prison, brought him back to New York, managed him, and he went on to influence all kinds of people like Dylan and the rest. But Alan took that even a step further, and he traveled throughout rural America recording folk music, not necessarily blues, but folk music. And he went out of the country. He even went to Italy and recorded Italian folk songs. And one Christmas, I gave my mother a CD of Italian folk songs, and she looked at it and she goes, "You gave me a CD?" I said, "Mom, just listen to it." So she calls me up 2 days later and she says, "There's songs on this CD I haven't heard in 70 years from when I was a little girl still in Italy." And that's what the Lomaxes did for our music, which would have certainly have been lost if it wasn't for their field recordings. So they went into Parchman Farm in the 40s, Alan did. He recorded two CDs of prisoners and their work songs. And to me, it's a real short, small step between what they're doing and the blues. To me, blues is a feeling. You know, everybody in this room at one point or another has had the blues. The Queen of England, with her crazy family, had the blues from time to time. So I'm gonna have my trusted, overpriced assistant play the first song. It's called No More. It's just a guy chopping a tree down, and Alan Lomax recorded them, and further on in the recording, you can even hear a wood chip hit the microphone. But we'll play a little bit of that, and then I'll turn it into a song. Maestro. Okay. Good job. All right. So let's say we were there and we had the guy put his axe down and said, "Come on over here and just play that." And it probably would have come out something like this. Thank you. So you can see there's not that much difference between those two, other than first one, he's got an axe in his hand, and the second one is perhaps he has a guitar in his hand. Again, you know, blues is a feeling. The next one is another song, same place, same recording person, but it's four guys. And these work songs weren't just something to do. If you could lead the squad in a work song, you got better treatment than the other people. Now, what better treatment is in the 40s being a black guy in a prison in Mississippi? I'm not sure what that is, but that supposedly is the deal. And they had a tree, they had four guys, and they put them in the corners. So this song would coordinate it so these guys would hit, and then those guys would hit. And it would alternate. So this way, people are swinging axes, and they're not chopping off arms. Okay, hit it. That's it for all the electronic stuff. And from now on, we'll just go acoustic. But I think it's a great way to start off this thing. So I'll take that and I'll put that to music. And for those of you who know who Doyle Bramhall II is, he recorded this song with his band, and it's really cool. And that's what gave me the idea to do it myself. But Doyle Bramhall, he played with Clapton. And the chords I'm gonna use for this song, you've probably heard. Like a million times. But I'm gonna use those same chords, which is a four and a flat third for those of you into music. And we're gonna make a song out of this right now. See where you can go from there, putting in solos and other instruments and that kind of thing. So again, for me, blues is a feeling, and it kind of started from the reading I have done. It was people from sub-Saharan West Africa, like Ghana, Angola, that kind of thing. And then also southeastern Africa came over. Some came straight to the States. They were a little more restricted because they couldn't play drums and their instruments. It was very restricted. But some of them came over to the Caribbean, and there they didn't have those restrictions. And that's where the banjo was invented. It's an African instrument. And when you see it today, you know, all fancy and metal and all that kind of thing, it's just a continuation of the original banjo, which is the way this guitar is tuned, banjo tuning. So you had people with an incredible sense of rhythm, but they couldn't, like, they didn't have their instruments. You know, when they came over, nobody said, now make sure you bring your instruments. So they had to play what was here, which was violins and pianos and guitars and harmonicas. And the whole thing kind of melded together pretty much in what's called the Mississippi Delta. And that's the state of Mississippi, not the Mississippi River. Mississippi River Delta is right at the end where it goes into the Gulf of Mexico. There's a region of the state of Mississippi. The northern terminus is Memphis. The western side is the Mississippi River. The eastern side is the Yazoo River. And then the southern terminus is Vicksburg. And the Yazoo River was pretty important. Grant's campaign at Vicksburg, for those of you who read about that. But in that area, there must be something in the water, because it all practically came from there. All these artists that you've heard about, Clarksdale, Greenville, all these little towns, and it was basically like black folk music, but it was different. You know, it had this emotion to it, and it just went from there. I mean, Elvis, when he wound up in Memphis, he was trying his best to play like a black guy. And some of his buddies were black artists. Big Boy Crudup, who wrote That's All Right Mama. You know, he was a Delta blues musician. So in the beginning, the music was not as complex as it is now. There seems to be standard forms for playing blues these days. You can play a blues song just about in any format, as long as it has the feeling. And there was a guy by the name of Charley Patton, and from when you go back in time, it gets narrower and narrower. And from the recording side of things, it really starts with Charley Patton, as far as I know. He died in 1934. And he wrote a song called Pony Blues, which was a big hit for him. Now, I don't know how many records he sold to be called a big hit, but they asked him to do another one. Do another one like that. And, you know, there was no internet, so nobody knew anything, and he basically ripped himself off, and he wrote a song called The Stone Pony Blues. And that name, The Stone Ponies, is why Linda Ronstadt called her band the Stone Ponies, in a tribute to Charley. And a lot of these rock and roll people, they try to play tribute to the original blues masters. You know, Stephen Stills, big blues guy, grew up in Florida and heard all the black churches. And on their first record, the last song, I think, is called 49 Bye-Byes. And it starts off, you know, this guy out in the field, he's going, you better come on, my kids, because it's going to be raining. You know, then he comes in with the song, 49 Reasons, all in a line. But what that guy's saying is, you better come on in my kitchen, because it's going to be raining outside. And that's how a Robert Johnson song begins. Come on in my kitchen. Dylan, I mean, the list is endless. All the British guys, you know, Clapton. There was a time in Clapton's life, I read in his biography, that he said, if you didn't know who Robert Johnson was, I wouldn't even talk to you, which is a little over the top. But, you know, Jimmy Page, Jeff Beck, all of them are drawing from this music. So I think it's time to play some. I'm going to do a version of Pony Blues, and I'm not going to play the whole song because it limits how many songs I can get to. I'll play a couple verses of it just to give you the idea of what I'm talking about. But it's a simple tune structurally. It's basically a D chord, and this guitar is tuned T to a D chord. And I don't think I've mentioned it, Wayne, but I encourage you to ask questions. If there's something you want to know or something you think I missed, just, you know, raise your hand and we'll take it from there. Please ask questions. Okay, so Son House did a version of Pony Blues because he probably convinced somebody he wrote it and he could get paid for it. And I'd like to do his version because he actually wound up in Detroit and he's buried at 5 Mile and Losher in this really small cemetery. And the Detroit Blues Society did a really cool thing getting him what they thought was a proper headstone. But the thing is the size of a small refrigerator, and you couldn't even put it at the head of the grave. It's like over the grave, the whole thing. And, you know, he's certainly not going anywhere. But you can go visit that, and there'll be little whiskey bottles and harmonicas and all that kind of stuff all over it. But the song itself is pretty simple. You know, this whole thing kind of started out fairly simple. So, Son House. In this area, if you like what I'm doing, you need to go look up the Reverend Robert B. Jones. He is the definitive authority on all this stuff. He's a nationally known guy. He has a church down in Detroit, and he does many, many things in this vein. He also had a radio program on WDET called Blues from the Lowlands. He had another one called Deep River. Any questions? Yes, sir.
What did the evolution, or how did they get started playing with the slide guitars? Did they just pick up a dobro, when did the dobro come about?
All right. This could take a while. The slide bit, the first reading you'll do of that is when W.C. Handy was waiting for a train at Tutwiler. And there was this guy playing with a knife as a slide. And that's the first time anybody ever heard that, where they wrote it down. For me, slide playing is very lyrical. It's more like singing. And, you know, how it started, I don't know. I would bet money that it's straight out of Africa. Because a lot of their instruments don't have frets and they use things to make the different sounds.
But then before the dobro?
Well, the dobro, I'll get to that story too. Okay. There was a guy named John Dopraya, and he was an immigrant. He was a Slavic immigrant, and he wound up in L.A., and he's one of these tinker guys. He's always fooling around with stuff. He was not a businessman. But back then, like in the early 20s, wooden guitars just weren't that loud. And you could come into something like this and bang away on a wooden guitar and no one would really hear it without plugging it in. And you couldn't plug it in back then. So he tinkered around with a design to mechanically amplify the sound. And this is it. Now, this is not an original National Guitar Company tricone, so there's no reason to try and steal it. But this is a replication. In the mid-80s, a couple of guys out in L.A. found John Dopraya. He was still alive. He still had his drawings. So they replicated the original tricone guitar. And underneath this cover here are 3 6.5-inch aluminum cones. And they vibrate when the strings vibrate. So it's just louder. You don't have to play it loud, but you can. The original tricones, they had a brass body, they were chromed, and they were beautiful. They were works of art. Dopraya was told, you know, John, we got to find a way to make these cheaper, because they're competing with Gibson and Martin, just, you know, like now. And he was having none of that, because he didn't care about making money that much. So he left the company. And the other guy, the business guy, is another common vernacular, is the bean counter guy. He took the same body, and he just put one big cone in it. So, and he did make the bodies out of steel. He painted them with hula girls, because the first people to use nationals were the Hawaiian guys because of the slide in the Hawaiian music. But John Dopraya formed another company with his brothers, the Dobraya Brothers, and that was shortened to Dobro. And they used wooden bodies. And this guitar, the strings are attached to the center of the cone there. On a dobro, there's these fingers that go out and attach the strings to the outer rim. So it gives it a more mellow sound. And the country guys like that, like Jerry Douglas and those guys. But blues guys, you know, they like that sharp attack. So a national single cone is not a dobro. That's another kind of guitar, totally. And I just happened to be on vacation in California, and we stopped by this company, and I asked them, you know, I don't want a hat or coffee cups or any of that stuff. I just want to know, what's it take to get endorsed by you guys? And the president said, well, you know, send me your stuff. And so I did. And in the letter, I said, you know, I don't want anything, and no matter what you say, I'm still going to play these things. But yes, I got endorsed by this company, the National Reso-Phonic Guitar Company, it has to be called, because the national name is still owned by, I think it's called Valco, is some company owns that. There's a guy, in my opinion, a unique American artist by the name of Blind Willie Johnson from Texas. And he would basically sing gospel songs, but they sounded like blues songs. And he had a pretty tough life, but one of his tunes, Dark Was the Night, Cold Was the Ground, is a song where it was so emotional, he did not sing it, he just moaned on it. And he played his slide guitar. And that song was selected by NASA to be on the golden record of the Voyager spacecraft. So Blind Willie is up there with Beethoven and Chuck Berry. But this song is called Trouble Soon Be Over. and it's 1929, Blind Willie Johnson. And fortunately, he was recorded by Columbia. And even back in the late 20s, they had pretty good recording equipment. So if you pick up on these original recordings, they sound pretty good. There's a great version of this song because it was one of the tunes Martin Scorsese selected to be in his series, The Blues. It was a 10 CD set. And on this one, or not CD, DVD set. And on this one DVD, he covered Skip James, J.B. Lenoir, and Blind Willie Johnson. So there's this clip of Chris Thomas King pantomiming to this song, and it's all in scratchy black and white, and he's on a storefront, and he's playing the tune, and his wife's behind him singing, and there's the kids in the overalls and the hound dog and the old car going by. I mean, it's really cool. But and Chris Thomas King is a fine, fine player. He's going to come up later when I get into Skip James. So this is Blind Willie Johnson, 1929, Trouble Soon Be Over. Oh, got about two CDs worth of songs. So things moved right along. And there was a guy named Bukka White. He's another Mississippi Delta blues musician. And this young lady up front, beginning before y'all showed up, was talking about a movie called Two Trains Running, which was a pretty cool movie. And the two trains were like skinny white guys from New York going down south looking for old blues musicians. And people who looked just like them were also going down there trying to register all the people to vote. So they were troublemakers. And the blues guys sometimes got crossed up with the troublemakers. And when they gave the explanation of we're down here looking for blues musicians, they wound up going out the bathroom window, you know, getting out of town, as they say. But this song here is called Aberdeen, Mississippi Blues from 1940. One of those guys that I know his name, I can't recall it right now, he wrote a letter. Bukka White, blues musician, care of general delivery, Aberdeen, Mississippi, because of the song. And that letter found him. He was working up in Memphis, and he wound up having a second career. And you can see Bukka White on these black and white videos on YouTube. He was a cousin of B.B. King. And B.B. remembers Uncle, his cousin Bukka, because he would always give him candy when B.B. was a little kid. But Buka's he's this enormous man, and he looked like a refrigerator with a head on top. And he'd play these guitars, and they'd look like, you know, a ukulele. But he did one thing that's kind of cool in this tune, which is why I've selected it. Because you can use... You know, that, you know, when you think of the African thing, you have to think percussion. A very percussive way of playing music. And, you know, you read about Ginger Baker from Cream or Stuart Copeland from The Police, and they were very, very much influenced by African rhythms. The big Cream song, Sunshine of Your Love, you know, most accents are on the two and the four, but in Sunshine of Your Love, they're the one and the three. One, two, three. And that's African. And I think Ginger Baker even moved there after Cream broke up and lived there for a while. That guy was a true rock and wild man. If you've never seen the movie Beware of Mr. Baker, check that out. I mean, even by Keith Richards standards, Ginger Baker was a wild man. So anyway, I'll play a little bit of this Aberdeen, Mississippi blues thing. Kind of give you the idea.
Down in Aberdeen,
Yeah. So again, you can check that out on YouTube, Bukka White. I have cards which will have my website, leonardoblues.com. How original is that? And if you want to be cool, you can put your email address. Let me know where you're playing, and you put your email address in, and then you'll know. And that's how people find out about this. I also play in a band called Woodford Station, and I do the other side of World War II, the electric slide guitar, all the Duane Allman stuff I play in that band. But here's a song that kind of goes over because of the Rolling Stones. And there's a couple of these British guys, Keith Richards and Eric Clapton, who went way out of their way to educate America about its own music. And in that band, on the Beggar's Banquet album, they covered a song called Prodigal Son. Now, back in 1967, when I was a young, long-haired paper boy, I bought a copy that it said all songs by Jagger Richards, which was a bodacious lie, because they ripped off the Reverend Robert Wilkins from Hernando, Mississippi, first town south of Memphis, going into the Mississippi Delta. And the Reverend Wilkins, he was one of these guys, he couldn't figure it out. Son House was another one, Skip James was another one. It's like whiskey, women, preaching. You know, it's like this or it's that. And they could never quite figure out which end of that teeter-totter they were gonna go on. So the Reverend Robert Wilkins wrote two songs. One was called Prodigal Son, which was the religious song, and the other one was called That's No Way to Get Along, which was the secular version of exactly the same song. Prodigal Son was really written off of a couple of Jesus's parables in the Bible. And that's the version that the Rolling Stones covered. But I'm going to play the other one. You've probably heard this.
Started down.
back to Alan Lomax. He recorded a lady, Vera Wardhall. And he said that she had the sweetest voice that he ever heard, which is saying something, because that's, you know, comparing her to Ella Fitzgerald, people like that. Vera Wardhall, you know, lived down south. She did about 8 recordings that I found, and never had any music. She just sang a cappella, probably in her kitchen or something. And he recorded her. And I heard the song, Wild Ox Moan. And I just went, whoa, that's cool. But what do you do, like now, if you want to show up and play it for people? You gotta make up, the music part. So I heard a version by Jeff Muldar, who's an excellent blues player, and he did a version of Vera Wardhall's Wild Ox Moan, 1948. Sometimes it's called Black Woman. I've seen it listed that way too. But this is also available on YouTube, just the music. And funny thing about this tune is, you know, I'd play some of these songs and, you know, my mom would go like, oh, that was nice, you know, because that's what moms do, right? They don't ever say, I didn't like it. But this is the only song, this is the only song I played for my mom that she actually liked. So, in her memory, Vera Wardhall, 1948, Wild Ox Moan.
Well, now, right here, pretty woman,
Excuse me?
Your tritone, that national student D, what's the single tone tune to?
G.
That's G?
Yeah. Yeah, I play everything in open tunings. For me, even in the band, standard tuning to me makes no sense. It's like the English language. I can't spell it. I gave up trying. For me, if I play in open tunings, I sound more African, and that's my target. Yeah. But this is going to be going to D minor. You're getting that for the same price, which is really cool, but not right yet, because you brought up G. And I've already brought up Keith Richards. Which is he's a pretty cool guy. I mean, I've read his book, Life, and some interesting Keith Richards quotes. I never had a problem with drugs, just cops. And one time he and Ronnie, they're on the road, and the manager bangs on the door. Bang, 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 bang. Keith, Ronnie, the police are here. Oh, shit. And they get up, flush everything down to John, you know, and they wipe their nose, and they open the door, and it's Stuart Copeland and Sting. Yeah, pretty funny, huh? But anyway, Keith plays a lot in open G tuning, which is exactly what this guitar is tuned to. And he's not playing anything new. He's playing the same chords Charley Patton played at the turn of the 20th century. But he has an ability to take what everybody else does and turn it a little bit and make a great rock and roll song out of it. In that last song, I used these chords. Well, he would go. Get what you want. And Honky Tonk Woman. Start me up. There's about 60, 80 of them. What's the one we play? You don't know. Yeah, it's a great song, but it's blues. You know, it's like African blues coming out of England. and you know, he makes it work. Okay. Well, I'm gonna play. I'll play a blues song, unless there's other questions.
Mm-hmm. I mean, does this have to be with like what you spoke of, or just kind of a random question?
Well, you can, if you ask me how to like make ravioli, I mean.
Why is Chicago the home of the blues and not Detroit?
That's where they went, mostly. When it was time to get out of Dodge, a lot of things happened. Down in the Delta, for a long time, you had to have a lot of workers, and they actually ran out of black guys, and they imported some Mexican guys. They even went so far as to recruit a bunch of Italians from Ancona, Italy, promising them the world. You know, the streets are paved with gold. Then they bring all these guys over here, and it, you know, was no better here than there, of course. Mm-hmm. But yeah, and with the advent of the farm machinery, you didn't need all these people. So between that, the Great Flood of 1927, which was a horrific disaster for the United States, it like rained for 2 or 3 months, the entire Mississippi Basin swelled up. The Army Corps of Engineers never in a million years thought the Mississippi River would go that high when they built the levees after the Civil War, and the thing let go down in the Delta. And Charlie Patton has a song, High Water Everywhere. And all these blues bands come up with like flood songs and levee breaking songs. Led Zeppelin did a song, When the Levee Breaks, and it was about that event, which had a lot of political ramifications too, which I won't go into.
But that brought people up.
That, yeah, and that, you know, the train. I would say Chess Records was the primary reason. The Chess Brothers, they had it going on. They actually bought Howlin' Wolf's contract from Sam Phillips in Memphis, Sun Records, and the Wolf went up to Chicago, Muddy Waters. Mm-hmm. He went up there, and here's a cool story about Muddy. You know, when he was discovered, Alan Lomax again, our buddy Alan Lomax, he was down south looking for Robert Johnson, who by this time had already he had already achieved room temperature, and he was not available. But they people told him, oh, you got to go to the Stovall Plantation and hear this guy Muddy Waters. So they went there, they got Muddy off the tractor, and he's bare feet and in overalls and didn't have a guitar, so they gave him a guitar. And he played some songs for Alan Lomax, and that was his start. And I'm gonna play one of those songs when I'm done talking. But the funny part of the story is later on, after he's Chicago and, you know, big blues star, he goes back down south and he's like being driven around in a Cadillac. And says, hey, let's go to the Stovall Plantation. And, you know, they pull in and the big boss man, he comes out, he's working his tie and like, ooh, who's this important guy? Just came in, you know, here in a Cadillac, and Muddy rolls on the window and goes, I quit. And the first person that like composed Walkin' Blues is probably Son House. I've never been able to nail it down. Everybody does a version of this song. Eric Clapton covered it on his Unplugged CD. He basically took the way Muddy played it for Alan Lomax, used Robert Johnson's lyrics off of his version, and got an Emmy. So, good for Eric. So it's called Walkin' Blues.
Gotta find my baby. Woohoo, Lord, bring
seem like days. Gotta find my baby now. Whoa, change your evil ways. Seem like hours, several hours, seems like days. Butterfield covered that tune too on his second album, East West, out of Chicago.
I know, I was gonna bring him up.
You're gonna bring up Paul Butterfield?
Who's
yeah, yeah. Who's like one of the first white guys to play? I don't think white guys started playing blues till you could make money at it. But the chess.
It was a lot of harmonica, wasn't it, Matt?
Well, that's what he played. Yeah. Originally, he played other things later on. But yeah, harmonica. And, the Chess Brothers at 2120 South Michigan Avenue in Chicago had a recording studio, which is still there, upstairs. It's a lot like going to the Motown Museum here in Detroit. You know, very primitive recording, but that's where they all came from out of Chicago. Muddy Waters, Willie Dixon, Chuck Berry, man, even the Rolling Stones recorded there. Their second album, 12 by 5, the very first song on it is an instrumental called 2120 South Michigan Avenue, because that's where they were when they recorded it. And a lot of that album comes from there. My favorite Delta blues artist is a guy named Nehemiah Skip James from Bentonia, Mississippi. Really small town, Bentonia. And he would play in the open D minor. There was a guy named Henry Stuckey who unfortunately was never recorded. And when he was over in Europe in World War I, he learned this tuning from some guys from the Bahamas. And he brought it back to Bentonia. So if you were a guitar player in Bentonia, you played that way. There was Henry Stuckey, Skip James, later on Jack Owens, and John Cephas even would play that way sometimes. So I'm going to play a couple of tunes by Skip James. And when you read his biography, he had a hard life. Even by black guy in Mississippi standards. Just was not working out for him, but he recorded in 1931. They sent him up from Bentonia, Mississippi to Grafton, Wisconsin. And the reason they did that, there was a guy down there, H.C. Spear, he had a furniture store, and he was a talent scout. So if you went and played for him and he thought you were good, he'd ship you off to one of these recording studios. And up in Grafton, there was a furniture factory, and off in the corner, they had a recording studio. And the reason for that is back then, the record players were all made out of wood. So furniture factories would make the record players, and they would also sometimes record records, so they'd sell them to you, so you'd buy the record player. And Grafton is a small town even today. But a lot of people were shipped up there to record. There's a car with Charlie Patton's son House, Willie Brown, and a lady, Louise Johnson. They all went up to Grafton to record. And the start of the trip, she was Charlie's girlfriend, and at the end of the trip, she was Son House's girlfriend. And I thought, you know, they'd probably make a pretty cool movie. But so many records came out of there. There was the Paramount recording studio, and the Paramount label just happened to get, like, all the really good guys. It got to the point where people got scuba gear and went through the river that joins the where the furniture factory was, looking for old masters that might have been just thrown in the river to get rid of them. So a lot of music was lost. You know, Willie Brown, he's mentioned in Crossroads, which will be a song I'll sing later. He was a friend of just all those guys, Charlie Patton. There's only four records of his that have ever been found. Skip James, there's only 36 records total that have been found of his 18 songs that he recorded. Some of them, there's only one copy of the record exists. So if you get the complete Skip James recordings, you're listening to that one record of that song, because that's all that's ever been found. And one of the tunes he wrote is called Illinois Blues. And it's a cool tune because it sounds real happy, you know. But then he hits this flat third to kind of imply it's not really true. And I thought that was a pretty cool trick. So this is Illinois Blues by Skip James, 1931. Thank you. Not a song by Skip, unless it's a question. Nope. Is, yes. Yep. No, 78s. Yeah, this is Skip recorded in 1931. Yeah, they're all 78s. I actually had an opportunity, and it's on my bibliography right at the bottom. There's a DVD of this guy, Joe Bassard, who spent his entire life scouring the countryside around Frederick, Maryland, looking for old 78 records, and he has an enormous collection. And in that movie, Desperate Man Blues, it said he always had breakfast at Barbara Fritchie's restaurant. And Barbara Fritchie was the lady as Lee and his army is invading the North for the first time on their way to Antietam. Barbara Fritchie went out on the porch and waved an American flag in front of the invading army. So that's the name of the restaurant. So I called him up. I said, does Joe still have breakfast here every day? Oh yeah, all the time. I said, give him my number. So I'm driving up Woodward, you know? And it's Joe. So I said, we're gonna be visiting your way, you know, next month, and can we stop by? Yeah, that'd be great, stop by. So I went and actually saw his basement and all of the posters and everything he had, and I heard Blind Willie Johnson's original recording from 1928, Dark Was the Night, Cold Was the Grind, on his stereo. Oh, wow. And it was spooky good. You know, a pristine copy of Robert Johnson's Crossroad Blues. You name it, he had it. And he had a wall as long as this red curtain in his basement. And it's just full of records in these gray sleeves. And nothing was labeled. I mean, he knew where all of them were. He has since passed, and I think someone digitized this collection. But man, the movie's great. The movie's great. And all right, back to Skip James. He wrote another tune, which I kind of like, called Hard Time Killing Floor Blues. And in the movie, Oh Brother, Art Thou? Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? It was played, again, by Chris Thomas King, and it was a cool part of the movie because it's dark, and they're around a campfire, and they're running from the law. So it's perfect place and time to be singing a blues song. And I thought Chris Thomas King did a fine job on this song, but here's my version. Thank you. All right. So, any more questions, ladies and gentlemen, before, yes?
Do you know how Johnny Lane got a start in blues? Do you know Johnny Lane?
I know of him. You know, he's another young, well, maybe not that young now, guitar slinger guy. I mean, there's a bunch of them. How he got a start, he probably heard, you know, this or Stevie Ray Vaughan, you know, in the 80s. Stevie got a lot of people playing. But this kind of music, it grabs you or it doesn't, you know. I mean, everything's not for everybody. Specifically, how he got his start, no, I don't. Well, he was a big Albert King disciple. And Albert King is my favorite electric guitar blues player. If you want to call Duane Allman a blues player, which I wouldn't, it's one of the things he did. He could do a lot of things. But Albert was my favorite guy. I mean, just had such feel. So what a great, great voice. The Velvet Bulldozer was his nickname. Another... Albert King, the Velvet Bulldozer, yeah. He was another enormous guy. I mean, you wouldn't want to, like, argue about what you were getting paid that night on the gig with that guy. Recorded a lot at the original Stax Record recording studio south of Memphis, along with, you know, Booker T and the MGs and all the great, great music that came out of that place. Okay. So, it's about that time, right? Yeah. Well, seeing as you've been such a great audience, if you play these songs, everybody wants to hear Robert Johnson. And I have a couple of his tunes, but I'm gonna close with one of them. It's called Crossroad Blues. Everybody wants to hear Crossroads, and primarily because of Eric Clapton and Cream covering that tune. On their third recording, Wheels of Fire. They recorded it live. I loved it when it came out. I thought it was great, but I didn't know why. And it took a while for me to learn about music and the flat third and the flat seventh and the minor pentatonic scale and all that technical stuff. But that's why it appeals to me. And this was not Robert Johnson's big hit in his lifetime. That was Terraplane Blues, kind of a hokum tune talking about women in terms of a car, but another time. So again, Crossroad Blues, 1936, Robert Johnson. That about it? Yeah, okay. Any questions, ladies and gentlemen? Yes, ma'am.
Are there blues museums around the country or anywhere in particular?
2120 South Michigan Avenue is a museum now. And actually, Willie Dixon's granddaughter, who unfortunately looked just like Willie Dixon, gave me a tour when I went there. There's in Clarksdale, Mississippi, and if you're ever in Clarksdale, Mississippi and want to play music, drink the water, because there's something in it that makes you play great. Morgan Freeman has his Ground Zero place there. Yeah. And across the street or someplace close to that is a Delta Blues Museum. But it's like touristy now. Mm-hmm. You know, when I was there, the crossroads, there's this gigantic thing with two big guitars and it's right in the middle of Clarksdale. And I'm thinking, well, that's not right. but, you know, it's cool. Memphis is cool. Beale Street is cool. A museum, yeah, a little bit of this, a little bit of that. Yeah, nothing super big, but it's just cool to go to. You know, they have like rebuilt it because, you know, after Martin Luther King got shot, the whole place went up in flames. So it's kind of it's worth going to if you're near there. Yeah, Memphis is cool. Uh-huh. Good.
Thank
you so much. Well, my pleasure. My pleasure. So, want a card? They're free. And you can look at the website and see that. And I also play in a band. That's on there too. And hopefully, sometime in the future, I'll be back.